what, when we called this workshop and decided we need to discuss it, that time the Times and the Economic Times report said that the RBI is on the verge of announcing or issuing this circular. But in fact, they have, you know, the story was on the 12th, but the RBI had very quietly actually issued it on the 2nd. And normally, every circular of the RBI is sent out as a press release, but this is the only one which has gone so quietly. So 2nd was for all banks, 17th was for cooperative banks, and they haven't even made any attempt to inform anybody. So it's not come through the press release route, okay? It's come straight into the master circular, and it's quite by chance that we were searching, doing a Google search yesterday, preparing for this seminar, and we discovered that the circular is already issued. So, I mean, they know there's going to be opposition, otherwise they wouldn't have done it in this sneaky manner. So, we are saying that the bank has, the RBI has essentially told all banks, and contrary to what we thought from the ET report, it is not about new ATMs. They want everybody and everything to be biometric enabled. Okay, so the copy of the circular is here in case anybody wants to look at it. But so I'm just running through a few points that we were making. So there are going to be 200,000 new point of sale machines and 20,000 ATMs, but this is not relevant as of yesterday because RBI circular says that every ATM has to be biometrically enabled. We are, our starting point is to say that originally when all banks went into core banking, the idea was it will reduce costs and it will improve efficiency. But what has happened is, and there's a good reason why this has happened, while core banking is terrific and it connects everything, the RBI and the government continue their old ways, which means that every other day they issue a circular and a directive which requires change in technology. And everybody has to go back to the service providers, whether it's all the IT companies, and they're charging a bomb for every change. So every small little thing that you have to make, they're paying so much of money that banking and all these transactions that were supposed to be inexpensive, simple, they're all going, you know, they're just too expensive, and the banks have begun to complain bitterly, and they decide the prices. So IBA sits down and cribs ad nauseum about how, in fact, they've now begun to say, while they all went after salary accounts, they now say that we don't want 200 and 500 rupee withdrawals. So first they said they want everybody, they want inclusion. And now they say that every time you withdraw 500 bucks, we make a loss. So we think that transaction charges are not viable. Yeah. So this is one instance. It's the first case where they've gone and hiked up. So all of us were encouraged. Each bank told us, why don't you register for SMS charges? It's free and you get alerts. So now they've quietly started charging for this. As you know, Moneylife has definitely protested this. All of us did actually at the last seminar. So now the next thing is that they want them to be UID enabled. Everybody who's followed the whole Aadhaar development, you know that nowhere did UIDAI provide for the cost of scanners. And this is a question that we've been asking. You know that we had a seminar here, but for 4 years we've been asking, what is the point of doing biometrics if you are not budgeting for readers? Who will have the readers? Where is the electricity? Where are the connections? Now we find that all the cost has just quietly been passed on to banks, because if banks are given a quiet circular to say get it done, they get it done, and ultimately, we will be paying for it. So I'm saying that we need to react now because we will eventually pay for it. All the benefits are going to be part of this financial inclusion. So while we are all for financial inclusion, we ourselves know that there are going to be no transactions, because we have KC Chakravarti's own speech where he talked about a few hundred million accounts being opened, and most of them, I think 30 million, had a single transaction. So according to me, you make it biometrically enabled, all that will happen is that government will transfer economic benefits into the bank, and the only thing it will be used for is to withdraw those benefits, which means that there is going to be no business and no money that the bank is going to earn from this, which again underlines what we've been saying, that there'll be only a cost attached in providing it, and that cost can only be transferred to us who are otherwise regular users of bank, and there will be higher charges for us. Okay, the point I'm making is, we had again a speech of KC Chakravarti, who said that if even if every single person who has a bank account gets Aadhaar and UID, that is not what the aim of UIDA and Aadhaar was at all, because all of us have multiple identities. But the reason why they're bringing banking in through the back door is that the simple way to transfer costs and benefits is going to be from banks. Because you can build the infrastructure only if you force everybody into the banking system, and that is why they're working with banks in order to get Aadhaar. And what was voluntary is being made mandatory. Luckily for us, after the seminar has been announced, we've had the Supreme Court judgment, and so now in fact we can have a stronger voice when we demand that this compulsion should not happen. And all I'm saying is that we must demand what is the cost and where is it going to come from, because if banks have no money, we need to know where are they going to spend this money to enable biometrics. These are just numbers we're talking about. It'll be evident that existing ATMs will have to have biometric scanners, and existing ones will also need to install them. Okay, this is another important point. Biometric ATMs have been tried since 2004. I remember Citibank did it with much fanfare, launched it at Dharavi, and as Mr. D'Souza has been saying repeatedly and proving, and NGOs who have come here and worked with us, that a lot of people who work, who do labor, don't have fingerprints, and biometrics don't work. And you know, as shocking as it sounds, only we activists keep saying it repeatedly, that there has been no pilot, there's been no test for this Aadhaar thing, and nobody knows how many people who really deserve to get economic benefits even have an Aadhaar, or are going to be deprived of it merely because their fingerprints and iris is not accessible. So no pilot project, no feasibility, nothing has been done. Okay, this is, we wrote to Rajiv Chandrasekhar, and we're quite happy that he took it up. He's added another point about the kind of technology. I'm sure Mr. D'Souza will explain this better to us, the combination of chip and PIN authentication. I've just repeated the para for our benefit. So we will discuss each of these points after I run through them. Okay? And now, of course, like I said, the Supreme Court order strengthens our case. We are saying that we should have public policy which is intelligently devised, and we have to have a clear indicator of cost that can't be done by brute force. Okay, before we go to the discussion, those that did the demo already, but now the
he just registering his thumb fingerprint on the new iPhone 5S. It takes fingerprints from all the sides. Yeah, it's done now. So we'll check it again. He has already prepared one print. It's a plastic print. Just look, he is using another thumb and it's open.
This is one of the prints that I have here. It's made from Fevicol and wax. And this one is my wife's fingerprint. You use a wax template like this to melt wax in. Press your finger into this. You get your impression, which is the negative of your finger. And then you put in the Fevicol, let it dry for a couple of hours, and you get the skin. Now, Fevicol has the characteristic of being hygroscopic. So it it's practically an absolute imitation of your skin. And the liveness detections that are supposed to be detecting whether a fingerprint belongs to a person or to a fake is completely fooled by this very, very simple technology. The whole spoof costs about 15 rupees. One fingerprint for 15 bucks. What is essentially going to happen is wherever there are these biometric readers, it's going to be used as mules for all sorts of transactions, of which the persons owning the accounts will most likely not be aware. And even more dangerous, it can be used in cahoots with illegal elements to defraud the banks. It will be on such a massive scale, the banks will have absolutely no way of proving that somebody is really involved or not involved in a particular scam. Because the fingerprint will say, yes, it does, and he will have a cast iron alibi sitting in some restaurant or a police station or somewhere else saying, I was here, I didn't do this. And the banks will get defrauded. So, is everybody aware of biometrics? Okay. My name is J.T. D'Souza. I have been in the computing and embedded systems industry for nearly 35 years now. And part of my business activities has been access control systems, including biometric access control systems. So we've been doing biometrics for nearly 14 years now, primarily for diamond industry. Where they have very, very high valued assets stored. So we use them quite a lot and become very, very aware of the limitations and the strong points also of biometrics. So that's basically my background. Part of the activity involves making sure that the biometric readers themselves function as per what we require them rather than what the vendor says they are going to do. And so that's the background. Now, the specific part about fingerprints is, like you saw in the demo, the person registered with his fingerprint straight, but authenticated at a terrific angle. Essentially, the software inside the system actually helps in accepting a fraudulent fingerprint, because there are 100 ways in which you can place your finger, which is different from the original method on which you placed your finger. So therefore, even if your fake is just a very passable imitation, it works very, very well. In fact, it works better than your original fingerprint. Your original fingerprint, like all biological systems, age and changes. In fact, usually in a period of 1.5 years, you need to re-register. But a fake has no aging, it remains the same 10 years later also. Now, these prints that are made is about, I think, 2 years old. In the intervening period, I had to register my fingerprint twice on this thing, but this one works just the same.
Thank you so much. Yeah, in fact, he demonstrated this when we did a seminar at the Yacht Club. Just one request, take the mic. I'll give you a mic because we're recording it, so if you don't speak into the mic, it doesn't get recorded.
I am an electronics engineer by education, a postgraduate from IIT Roorkee. I've been associated with Infosys and TCS, and now currently head the IT consulting vertical for my organization. Actually, it's very simple, you know, replicating the fingerprint. It's like you just take it on a transparent sheet. The fingerprints are nothing but fat deposits and water. So you take it on a transparent sheet, sprinkling it with some, you know, fabricating powder to enhance it, and then sprinkle some super glue, which is nothing but wood extracts. And then you take a printout on 2400 dpi resolution, scan it, again take a printout on a transparent sheet, it's done. It's as simple as that.
My name is Captain Malkani. I wanted to ask Mr. D'Souza, when you say that you are doing biometrics, that means you are doing fingerprinting? Or are you taking the iris and any other method of identification? And another one, that now that you have got a handy fingerprint, what can you do with it? How can you profit by it? Or, I mean, may not be honestly, but how can you make money out of it? Okay, thank you.
I basically do biometrics most of the time. We have done two iris systems, but irises are extremely poor when compared to fingerprints. There are too many variations that the system cannot account for, and therefore the false reject rate is very, very high. Okay, so subsequently we have not done that particular thing, only fingerprints. Yeah. The second part is that irises are even more vulnerable to spoofing, because just a plain photograph is good enough to spoof the system. You don't require anything at all. A photograph is good enough. Okay. Yeah. The entire belief in biometrics as being unique and non-falsifiable, etc., etc., is just out of, you know, hype in the James Bond films. It's not unique. Whenever it's used in a database, one to many, you get huge number of hits. There has been never been any study on cases as large as the UIDAI claims, you know, 1.2 billion into 10 fingerprints being matched against one fingerprint. It has never been done. All the claims are just claims. The software has not been tested. The FBI documents that describe the whole specifications has huge number of lacunae and was never ever meant to be used as a single point identifier for this type of things like ATM transactions, etc. Coming back to this particular fake, there are several methods with which you can game the system. This one now is a cooperative spoof where me and my partner make fake prints and we use each other's prints while having cast iron alibis that we were not the ones to execute a transaction. So I can go and withdraw money from my friend's account and he goes and tells the bank, pay up, I have not withdrawn. Okay, that's a cooperative spoof. The one that you saw is a non-cooperative spoof. Nobody needs to register this print into a template for making a fake. You're standing here, I can see several people's fingerprints. I photograph that, use the technique that this person has used, and generate a fingerprint. Now, all I need to do is skim your ATM card or your Aadhaar number in this case, which is a public document anyway and disclosed all over the place. Punch in the Aadhaar number, put this fake fingerprint, and I can access your money.
One, again, using the mic. The other problem is that we think that they said they talk about reaching economic benefits, right? Now, if somebody calls, like say a village moneylender calls everybody and says, give your fingerprints and keeps this little thing, he can withdraw everybody's money. He needn't even let them get anywhere near a bank, right? And the whole point is that you're going to do it for the poor. They don't have any rights. And who says that the local mukhiya, panch, you know, the panchayat or the moneylender is not going to line them up? There is virtually slavery going on over there. We don't do anything about it. If he says, I'm going to create this, how long? I mean, whether it is the Fevicol technique or the one he talked about, how many minutes is it going to take for him to create all this? And our political guys are not going to do it. So it's vast amount of money, tens of thousands of crores given away as subsidies, which can be pulled out by anybody. That is one. But I think for today's meeting, you know, we are more concerned about the fact that this untested technology, not passed through parliament, you're forcing banks. So you're doing two things. Axis Bank and HDFC have started allowing eKYC. So it's all going to be online. And the Aadhaar card is going to be proof enough to get your bank account. So which are these bank accounts and where is the money going to go, we don't know. And we are saying that you can't use this technology to go and spend more money where the cost will be borne by us.
Mr. Bani Atta.
Please be
No, no, we speak of...
Hello everybody, my name is Srikant. I am Honorary Secretary of Council for Fair Business Practices, CFBP. I am also of Agni and I am a finance professional. I am with Bhatia Hospital as Chief Executive Officer. First thing, I must compliment Moneylife for presenting a well-researched document. If I hope you all seen it, it has got brought out, is there for us all, whereby they have mentioned all the aspects of fingerprinting. A lot of things are there, so I am not intent to repeat everything what is mentioned there, but I ask you to go through that document. It has contained all the details of fingerprinting, its cost involved, what are the different aspects. Very well researched and very well supported by facts article is there. I would just like to mention few things which come to me. First thing, fingerprint. I would like to mention that I am a techno-savvy person and I like this modern technology, and I feel that fingerprinting is really a good technology which identifies a person, and a lot of benefits are there. No doubt about it, and there is absolutely no denying the fact. But there is other side which you have to see, where the reality of life is. The technology is definitely good, and it is definitely has got unique identification mechanisms. So that technical part I am not discussing here. What is fingerprinting, how technical it is sound and all these things. But practical aspects in Indian environment, that is what I would like to stress more, because that is what is more relevant here. First thing, because I have used this fingerprinting technology in my own organizations, and I find fingerprinting, though it is good, on a massive scale as India projects. In Western countries, they don't have that large numbers. We are having 130 crore people. So there's very massive scale fingerprinting is there. And it is extremely slow in that. It cannot be fast. It will take minutes probably to identify. If you go, a person who is fingerprinted in Haryana and comes in Mumbai and puts its finger there, it will be extremely slow to learn through all databases. And if he has to key in his other identity number, then in that case, it is not applicable to illiterate person. But the whole idea of fingerprinting is that its illiterate person should be able to use it. And if he is able to key in some number, then in that case, very well, fingerprinting is not needed. He can very well key in his ATM number. This is basically meant for people, not for us basically, but for people in the villages who are not that, who don't know how to use ATM otherwise. So that is very essential fact, and I doubt if they have really done their homework about that aspect, practical aspect, how far it is really being usable. And other thing is that there are many people who don't have fingerprints. A lot of people, not just villages, workers, etc. I myself don't have fingers. We have got fingerprinting machine, attendance system in our hospital. If I put my finger earlier, it used to take a lot of things, and they say not recognized. Then they have given me one escape route by which just I key in my identity number and password, then I go through it. And it is my password, for your example, there is no secret about it, is 1234. Because I have to remember that. Otherwise, if I give some odd number every time, I have to search my this one and see what is my password and make that entry. 1234, I know, 1234 easy. So it is something like that. And that is the whole security aspect of fingerprinting, because my finger doesn't get registered there. So, but that is a practical, good or bad, that's not an issue. But that is the thing which is there. And if it happens with me, it must be happening many places. And we have to have solution for that when we go this fingerprinting. See, what I would like to stress, if fingerprinting is to be used for attendance, okay, no problem. If you don't have fingerprint, you do this. But when you are using fingerprinting for drawing the cash, then it is unthinkable. Even 1% error cannot be. 1% is 1 in 100 that you have had a chance that you lose your money. Who would like to take that chance? Nobody would like to take that chance. It has to be foolproof. So if we are using fingerprinting for ATMs, that is just unthinkable. That any way that limitation in that system, it cannot be just go it unless it is fully tried. See, this one aspect which just recently, yesterday's circular which you have put it, which I would like to draw your attention, that is very, very serious. I am extremely concerned about it. And irrespective of, even after, for the sake of argument, we assume that fingerprinting is good, everything is good. But some few days back, there's quite a few days back, maybe 2 weeks back, they have issued a circular whereby they implemented it, where it has not been even reported in newspaper. And we are sitting here debating whether it is needed or not. And they have already implemented it on some 17th... So, I don't know how you discovered it. It is something... Googling it. So, this is... What is the state of affairs in this information technology you are living, and you have to rely on Google search to find out that Reserve Bank has issued a circular? I can't... hello, when we are debating whether it is needed or not and all this thing, and that smart person there is issuing the circular, what is there that clandestine way, I am using that word purposefully, clandestine in a very secretive way where they go and they issue that circular by which fingerprinting is implemented, that is highly, highly objectionable. Just for that single reason only, I would say ki such an important measure which has got a lot of implication and ramifications of poor mind in the villages, and you can't just go about, it's not a child's play. Any error or any immaturity or any without full preparation, if you issue it, then it's a very vast, it may devastate lives if somebody misuses it. So this is not correct way of doing it, particularly for fingerprinting when it is connected with ATMs. And I would like to draw your attention to other state about high technology. Generally, high technology works, but it, unless the system which is going to use that technology, if that system is corrupt or inefficient or negligent, then no part, even after 100 years, nothing is going to change. The poor will remain there. It will not, nearly at present, 40% to 50% of our development debt doesn't reach the poor. It goes in between. That will still remain. On the contrary, it will happen in organized way. And you will not be able to catch. Now, I will give some examples. In university, we have got all this computerization, all this thing. For several years, their accounts are not audited. They don't have statements. Nothing is there. It's really horrible state. This is the epitome of knowledge. They teach us what teachers' account details, and their own accounts are not audited. Their own account, we don't get all the details, in spite of all the computerization technology. In BMC, they have spent more than 100 crores. They appointed Tata Consulting Services. They have got SAP systems. If you go to, I used to be part of Agni, I used to go to BMC office. Some 7-8 years back, they introduced a system that, again, same analogy I can see with fingerprinting. You go at the entrance, previously used to give letters to the person concerned, but now they say that person sitting at head office should be able to monitor with good intention that citizens' complaints are addressed properly in time and somebody ensures ki proper justice is given. So you enter it in the gate at the main entrance. So they enter into the computer, they give you a number, and then it goes inside. That's all. That's a good system. And so that it gets registered and goes inside, and from head office somebody will see if your complaint is monitored or not. Nothing is happening. When you go it, now they discontinued that also. When you get it number, that's only number is happening. And if you follow it up, then they will say ki it is under process and all these things. Even 1% improvement of BMC functioning has not happened because of that system. You see those, including ward officers level, AMC level, if you go there in the office, there is a computer sitting at back. So when we ask him, last time I asked him, that fellow, I don't want to take his name, ki, are you using this computer? He said, yes, very much I am using it, because he knew that I would try to find some meaning out of it. So I asked him, what is that you are using it and all this thing? He has no answer. He said, we are using it for seeing our complaints and all this thing. Then I asked him to put on that computer and let me see. Yeah, we are the friendly manner, not as an accusing manner. He was not able to show anything. That computer lying idle, and within 3 years that model becomes old, obsolete. That technology becomes obsolete. So all that money spent is goes down the drain. Today, BMC level, no improvement with computerization. They have got RTI Act which says that all the information should be paid on the web so that there is occasion for retrieving information is less. You can directly go from the web. Nothing is implemented. Even 5% is not implemented in spite of this modern technology being available. Income tax. There's a classic example. We are asked to make file our claims in through internet and all those things. I have got occasion to attend income tax hearings. We go income tax hearing, same old meeting, heaps and heaps of files are there. When we go there, then he calls that, he calls our files, he brings it there. The only improvement is that some secretary or whoever is that person is sitting in his cabin, keying in, typing in anything. But practical wise, nothing. We have to submit everything manually. He goes through everything manually, makes notings manually, everything manually, in spite of their government has put how many couple of thousand crores of rupees in computerization. Our income tax hearing doesn't make changes. He still goes by everything manual. Now, if this is the state, and this is not today's thing, this technological upgradement happened last at least 10 years. Nothing has improved. In this background, if we are not capable of using the technology, our system doesn't take care, manual system, our political system, administrative system is not able to take care of using that technology properly. And still we are, some person is thinking, if I know fingerprinting, I've used it, it's good, so let us implement it. We want to have better India, modern India, high-tech India. I think we are living in a different world, but that is also, we have no objection. But don't play with people's hard-earned money. That is what the important thing. If you want to do it, but don't play with the money which people is hardened. That's only I'm trying to say. And other factor which they have mentioned, which is relevant, we have to see, is the cost of fingerprinting. It's extremely high cost of fingerprinting. Even without fingerprinting also, ATM you have mentioned is 14 rupees and 18 rupees per transaction is there, that's already cost. So I don't know how much fingerprinting will cost it. That also factor has to be considered. Thank you.
Okay, what I was thinking is, Indrani will speak, Mr. Rawat will come later, Mr. Utki, after this, he's All India Bank employees. Who wants to speak next? After.
I'm Indrani Malkani, trustee of e-Citizens Action Network. Not being that much into technology, but common sense makes me ask a few questions. One is that Aadhaar number, in the circular of the RBI, we see that the Aadhaar number is what is going to authenticate, etc. Whereas the RBI is asking for eKYC, which is then the direct responsibility of the banks concerned. Now, when they are the biometrics, are only going to be from the Aadhaar biometrics? Is that what is understood? If that is so, then what is the system of the biometrics being stored? Who's storing it? Who's got the responsibility? None of these questions have so far been answered. These questions have been put to various ministers, concerned ministers, at some point or the other in the past few years. And there has been no reply, no clarity. So under these circumstances and in the scenario of terrorism, which we are hearing every other time, with our fingerprints, apart from the technical aspect of it, I am speaking purely from the security point of view, that there is no clarity, no commitment by either the banks. The banks are not taking responsibility for the biometrics. So if they are not the ones who are doing it, then who is taking responsibility? How can a bank accept an authentication of some, whether it is paper or whether it is biometrics, which is not authenticated by themselves? It common sense says that it's the custody of our monies. The banks are the custody of our wealth. Now, under those circumstances, if the banks take the responsibility of the biometrics, then there is one issue on which we may discuss. But if the banks are not taking any responsibility, and the responsibility is being accepted, that there a system is being accepted which is not of their making, that means at the end of the day the banks are not responsible. If the banks are not responsible for this, and yet the charges for updating their ATM machines is going to fall on the customer, and the customer is not sure of their money, it just doesn't make sense. Logically, it is, in every aspect it seems it is not only flawed, but at the end of the day it is criminal, because the trust of the customer, the bank depositors, is compromised from the very beginning. As far as the Aadhaar numbers are concerned, the RBI, which is the custodian of our entire country's finance, to say, to have this link with the Aadhaar number, which itself is under the cloud, then we wonder that why, where is the redressal system? There isn't one. And even the other day, where some who are present here will know, I had raised this point regarding our election issue. That the reason why I'm saying is that many of you, since the summary revisions are going on, you might be faced with this. So I thought I will share this, that in some of the polling stations where the summary revision is going on, certain people were asked about their Aadhaar number, and certain very strange things were told, to which I asked our collector that how can you take an Aadhaar number for any authentication, considering the Aadhaar number is not given to a citizen of India, it is given to a resident. So it cannot be a proof, and voting can only be done by a citizen. It cannot be done by anybody else. So under these circumstances, there were so many flaws, and yet an institution like the RBI is linking all monies, whether it is individual amounts or whether it is company accounts or any other, all transactions, to a number which itself is suspect. Because if the bank was doing the biometrics, that is one issue which can be debated separately. But they are not doing it. They are not taking responsibility. So therefore, this whole thing, it makes no sense. However, as Suchata earlier mentioned, since the court, there is an interim order, obviously the RBI cannot act on what they have circulated. Because what is, I would like to see the order, does it say? What does it say? That if it is not mandatory, if the court interim order says it's not mandatory, then how can the RBI make it mandatory post the order?
The RBI is not making it mandatory, but they will spend the money first to create biometrically enabled ATMs and, you know, biometrically enabled transactions, because they're talking about EKYC. So our big concern is you're going to start blowing up money without Aadhaar being tested, the point
yes.
that you made.
Yes.
There is no recourse if there is any misuse, even among those who have Aadhaar. And a lot of people have got Aadhaar because of the LPG cylinders. Okay, so willy-nilly, that we don't know what's happening on the subsidy issue, because that subsidy is going to come into your bank account. So willy-nilly, you're being compelled to do it, because you will want your 300 rupees back per cylinder, which is only going to come into your bank account. And then all the compromises start. I think Vikram should be able to answer
yes,
this, Vikram,
right,
about this UIDAI database. What I understand is that the question that you asked, who's taking responsibility, I believe every time you put your fingerprint, it will go to the UIDAI database for authentication, and it has to come back, which means that you need the high-speed technology to reach there. They will authenticate and come. So all the mistakes over there, the bank accepts. And I think this is an important point that you made, which we have to put in the memorandum, which is that if there is a mistake there, the bank will say it's not our responsibility. So then if money is lost, and if someone's making a claim, then who's responsible for paying? And none of the circulars or anything talk about recourse. What happens? What is the grievance redressal? What is the method of proof? And if anything is compromised, what happens to your money? How safe it is? It's not even mentioned, discussed, or debated. But that is typical these days of everything that RBI does. They just issue a circular. They say it's issued to the bank. So we as customers don't have any role in it at all, which is why I'm saying that we as customers have to protest now before they start
Absolutely.
Spending the money.
Absolutely. And in this, I will just, since Vikram is also here, let me ask one more question and leave it for discussions, is that when the Aadhaar authentication is done, it is being sublet to third parties and fourth parties. And that is a fact. Because in between, when in Mumbai the Aadhaar was stopped, it happened in my front and backyard, so to speak, in Malabar Hill, where the theft was noticed, that the company which has been entrusted to take it was not the one who was storing the data. The data was being stored by somebody else whom they had subcontracted to. In under this chain of command, one is not at all aware where it is going. So therefore, the whole thing is so mind-boggling. Am I correct in saying what I said? Yeah, 1 minute. I'll just complete it, then the answer may be given. So these are few things that I thought I would like to table, because it is really very scary, and people who are not technologically savvy are made, not only not technologically savvy, generally there is a fear psychosis being created in society of amongst people, that if you do not do your Aadhaar number, then you are going to be absolutely unable, you will be to do anything. Now that, yes, you will not be able to transact, you will not be able to get anything, etc., etc., when this whole is based on something which is so terribly false. So as organizations which work in the realm of civil society issues, etc., as a trust, in fact, Ashok Malkani is also a trustee, we feel very strongly that we would like to join to make sure that such things do not happen, because this is an issue of governance. And when issues of governance are so badly compromised, and systems are so flawed right from its inception, then it is a very serious situation. Thank you.
Vikram?
Yeah, I'd just like to say that, thanks very much. Vikram Krishna, I'm also one of the activists in this struggle against getting some rationality on what's going on with UIDA, because we believe it was neither correctly created, nor is the actions it is taking place, that are taking place under its supervision, nor are they actually taking place properly. And in fact, their design itself is flawed, fundamentally flawed. And you know, you have JT D'Souza sitting over there at the table. He's actually shown how easy it is to fake this whole fingerprint process, and it's not going to be any better because it's an ATM than if it's a handheld authentication machine. This is a fundamental flaw in their entire design, and I'm really, really surprised to see how the Reserve Bank is gathered with ideas. You saw the news item, one of the vendors, NCR, of ATM machines is actually trying to sell a fingerprint based ATM in the country already. They put out a press release only two days ago. So one can clearly see that there is a kind of business angle to, or rather very narrow business angle by a certain, you know, small set of vendors who happen to be making ATM machines, who see an enormous possibility to change the entire swath of ATM machines, because the ones that are in use today will become obsolete instantly the moment this new system is introduced.
I would just like to elaborate what Indrani mentioned about responsibility. See, that is very vital. You mentioned that if bank has done its own fingerprinting, bank is responsible. But the bank is relying on some central authority for this one. See, connected with that is that how authentic is Aadhaar card? That's the fundamental question, which is at the center of everything. It is absolutely easy to get Aadhaar card. Now we see political banners at our street corners saying that Aadhaar Mela, where they put invite people to get Aadhaar card. And we have got earlier cases where you can get passport in the name of President of India, Prime Minister of India, or ration card in their names, big names, without any problem. Then what stops you from getting Aadhaar card in your own name? Somebody else is getting the Aadhaar card. We are thinking it is there, and somebody else holding your name and Aadhaar card, and somebody, if that is the whole thing, then somewhere village can draw money in your own name, because he is having Aadhaar card in your name and you are not bothered to register yourself in Aadhaar. It's very horrifying scenario is there, and this part, how they are going to ensure, and who is going to be responsible in that sense, I am saying. Ki not just the authenticity of the Aadhaar card, but who is going to be responsible for loss of money. Bank is not going to reimburse. Bank will say, ki, we have gone as based off Aadhaar card, and they are not responsible for negligence. So is the central identifying UID authority of India is going to reimburse the banks or the individual for loss of money on that account? That's very important.
My name is Yogesh Sapkale. I am deputy editor at Moneylife. My point, I'll coming back to the RBI circular. If you just see the circular, RBI has written that sign KYC user agency agreement with UIDAI. And UIDAI is collecting the data. It has authenticated its partners to collect the data. But UIDAI will sell the data to all users. They will be charging. It's not free. So even if the government wants to use the data, government has to pay the money. That is the thing in here. Yes, banks will also have to pay. Additionally, banks will have to deploy hardware and software for deployment of eKYC service across various delivery channels.
That means UIDA's concept, banks if want to use, they have to deploy their spend money for the hardware and software as well. Then banks also has to develop a software application to enable use of KYC across various customer service points, including bank branches and business correspondence. And for this purpose, bank will have to develop their own software. So again, IT companies will benefit.
In this point, then this begs the question that the software which will be used by various banks are not going to be uniform. So therefore, each bank will develop their own software, which means that there is no uniformity in systems. Because the software, how would that work?
No, I'll tell you, what happens is that there are only three vendors or four vendors who are providing core banking solutions. Yes. So it's back to monopoly because they're the ones who got the contract. So it'll be Infosys, it'll be Oracle, it'll be TCS. And they're the ones who've done the core banking. And in fact, all banking charges go up. And, you know, I'm on Bank of Baroda Services Committee. And the point that I make to them is, are you not able to negotiate technology costs? But this is a point we have made to the RBI also. We have said that the RBI also has to maintain discipline and not keep issuing what I call directives or fatwas at will, so that, you know, look at this now. Without any discussion, without any understanding of costs, they've just said, do it, right? So when are they going to figure out? So banks have to listen to the RBI. So they will start implementing it, because afterwards the next circular will be that you have to do it by this date, which means the money will be spent. Then they will say that it's expensive. So instead of 14 rupees and 18 rupees per transaction, they'll say it's 100 rupees. And then that's when we come into the picture, when all the money is spent, which is why I'm saying for once, let's react much before it happens. Sorry.
I'll be putting forward 2 points. Number one, as far as the software is concerned, Siddharth. 2 points. As far as the software is concerned, very standard packages. Either it's FlexCube or it's Finacle from Infosys and FlexCube from iFlex, which is now Oracle Financial Services. So a selected set of companies will benefit. Point number two, let us assume everything is perfect. You know, there is no discrepancy, there is no duplication of data, the biometric system is fantastic. But now currently what happens is, once you swipe in your card, there is a digital verification. Your data is digitally stored, against which the PIN number is verified. Now once you implement this biometric system, it will be image mapping. So once you, you know, put on your thumb impression will be compared or will be verified against the 1.2 billion images stored. That is a huge and huge time consuming activity. So a transaction now which takes 30, 35 seconds, 40 seconds can run into several minutes. So you may actually go to an ATM, spend 10 minutes per person, because of which the user will suffer a lot.
I was about to make the same point, because if you see the procedure of eKYC norms, the person will walk into the branch and hand over his 12-digit Aadhaar number to that customer service representative. The representative then will put the biometrics with UIDA compliant biometric reader. The software will capture it along with biometric data, encrypt this data and send it to UIDA's central depository, identity data repository. And it takes a long time. And you know the connection speed which we have, it will take at least 1 minute to send the data of single person. Yes, sir.
Yeah, just so that this meeting is not under false impression, I'd like to say it's not the image that will go, actually. Okay. It's being converted into a digital form, guess what, with a huge compromise. There is a compromise on how that digital image is converted to numbers, because if you send the whole digital image print or something like that, huge file, that's not acceptable, so a small file. So they make a compromise, and that compromise is highly questionable, let me tell you. It's highly questionable. It is of the print scanner wallahs that it's okay. opinion, only a live, widespread public test can reveal how good it is. And that widespread test, as it happens, has been carried out in South Korea. And South Korea decided that it was not good enough to use for the whole population. They would need to register everybody's fingerprints every time just to keep their database up to date. At whatever cost that will be.
Else wants to intervene, talk, raise a point?
As Vikram rightly pointed out, in the authentication process, there is a method known as template extraction. So it picks up certain specific characteristics on your fingerprint, and that is forwarded to the database, and the database then checks with its own extraction process, compares and decides yes or no. But in case of EKYC norms, they will have to absolutely capture the entire image, fingerprint image, on a multi-finger scanner and update that onto their own servers itself, which means they will essentially have to duplicate that particular infrastructure at least to certain extent, if not the entire extent, because the EKYC stuff will have to be stored with a bank, right? It can't just be left entirely to the UIDAI authorities. So all this data will have to be duplicated here. Every time you duplicate data, you are introduced one more hole into the system. Every point you have on your laptop, on a CD-ROM, while in transit, they are all security holes and they are security breaches actually. And this entire system of running over public infrastructure for creating authentication services and registration services is very, very, very deeply flawed.
Can you, Vikram, tell us whether any of this software is ready and available? Because they've issued the circular, right? So will they start developing now based on this, or is anything available?
The whole fingerprint and biometric recognition software is based on FBI's FPIS system. It's a specific system which has lots of rules and regulations about how the database is done, how the fingerprint template is extracted, etc., etc. There are three vendors who have been finalized by UIDAI, but the core technology comes from one point single vendor, L1. Formerly L1, now Safran Visage. Okay, that company has direct links to the CIA and US's NSA. It has direct links. Even worse, which is not directly connected with this particular aspect, are NEFT and other back-end bank transactions mandate a cryptographic card from a specific vendor which is known to have flaws inside, but is being totally overlooked by RBI. So that's on a little bit side note. So the software itself comes, the core engine for authentication comes from Safran Morpho, as it is now called. What will happen is TCS or Wipro or Oracle or whoever will be buying this particular engine, loading it onto the bank's core banking services. The fingerprint reader also are a couple of vendors who are shortlisted. One of them is a fake one which I use over here, known as Suprema. Okay, and the process doesn't involve any extra security features or mechanisms in the fingerprint readers. It is merely a certification process that says, okay, this one conforms to these 10 points. And for the So for that specific purpose, the users of these fingerprint devices are going to pay a huge extra amount merely for having the certificate from UIDAI. It doesn't enhance the readers in any way. There is no extra security involved. There is absolutely nothing that enhances the system except the cost.
can speak on behalf of OT.
Good evening, friends. I represent the AIBA, Mr. Udgi and myself. I am M.K. Mandal, and I'm a retired banker. I've been in now 9 years after retirement. We are very happy to associate with the Moneylife and its programs. Some of the points which are emerging here, Mr. Udgi will also cover in as far as costs, etc. are concerned. Now, basically, I'd like to tell you that the computerization program in the banking industry is still not complete. Many of you feel that because of CBS systems, etc., it's all over. It's not. It's still incomplete, and even today, the banks are facing problems as far as CBS is concerned. So this is one of the points which will need to be considered by the respective banks when they go in for this fingerprinting systems. So far, as far as we know, bank managements have just received the circular. Nobody is even thinking about what to do about it. And rightly, as Mr. D'Souza has said, the entire onus of deploying and creating software, etc., is going to be left to the respective banks. Now, that would obviously mean a huge cost to the respective banks. So the second question would come, which Suchita has raised, who will bear the cost? Now, over the years in computerization in banks, the costs have so far been borne by the banks, but at the same time, it has been borne by the public because it's taken out of the balance sheets of the banks. So this is an indirect method in which the public is affected. The customers are also affected. We, as far as trade unions are concerned, of course, we've always borne the brunt of the customers because it's their money and they always want their money immediately. And therefore, this compromise system came through a system of agreement with the unions in 1985. Now, that modernization, I feel, has still not reached that particular level. And even today, there are banks. And I'm not talking about only nationalized banks. I'm talking about banks, cooperative banks, banks in the rural areas. Who is going to benefit from this entire concept is probably something which we as trade unions look at. When 40% of the people of our country are still don't have a bank account, this kind of modernization, according to us, is only going to benefit a very few people, especially the vendors. Which they are. So therefore, our concern is from that angle as well. So this is what we have to add. And there are lots of problems. I mean, even today in your accounting systems, you find problems. If you're going to link it to Aadhaar, I have my personal experience in which I did my Aadhaar card a year and a half ago at the Mahim post office. And I still haven't received it. After continuous follow-up, I'm told that your data is lost. So you'll have to go and do your fingerprinting again. So, yeah. Well, no. They say it's lost. I don't know whether it's misused. Exactly. I don't know where it is. All I'm saying is that, as far as I know, I haven't received my Aadhaar card, and I got a reply from them after 1.5 years saying, you will have to do this. So if that kind of a complication is there, you can imagine what is going to be the likely outcome of this. In fact, I think there are, rightly somebody has talked about fingerprinting, etc. But I think some banks are even going ahead and talking about facial recognition through ATM. And Union Bank is one of them where they've got talking ATMs as well, probably for the handicap, but I don't know how effective that is. And the point is that your existing ATM costs a minimum of 3 to 5 lakhs. It can only be made profitable if you have at least 100 hits on each ATM per day. So whether that kind of profitability of the bank will also occur, we don't know. Therefore, they are passing it on to the customers per se. Now they've migrated into SMS system. They're talking about passing on that cost as well. So when you talk about fingerprinting, you should also try to raise the question of why should SMS costs be passed on to the customer. So these are the few points I'd like to make. I'm sure Mr. Udgi would also like to contribute something.
Okay, after the last two, we should try, I think, to do that memorandum. So, you know, everyone's made very interesting points. So let's make the closing points, whoever wants to speak. And if you all give me 5 minutes each, let's try and complete the memorandum that we want to send jointly. Yeah? So you will speak first?
Yeah. Or you will also speak.
My colleagues, Mr. Mandal, has made certain points. I represent All India Bank Employees Association as a vice president at national level, and at the Maharashtra level, I'm the general secretary. The point is basically, entire banking system is customer-centric or customer-oriented. This is a new phrase. Whether it's the private sector or the public sector, the foreign sector, or the corporate sector. Now, when the customer satisfaction is the most important thing before us, now technology is playing a key role. Now, here, those who own the technology and those who operate the technology with the money power, they are calling the shots. They are basically monopoly companies at the international level and the national level. They are having a big lobbies and they operate in RBI top branches and Ministry of Finance. And of course, PMO office. So when the when in the banking industry, the competitors were introduced, Rajiv Gandhi's time, we negotiated it and we got it truncated competitors and we got some benefits. That part is apart. But then, now technology is taking progress, and as I said, still, core banking solution is not fully implemented in the banking industry. And now, core banking solution in public sector, 100% okay, but not elsewhere. Now the question is, phone bank, internet banking, mobile banking, ATM banking, this process is on. Now here, all the lobbies are playing. And now you must have heard 10 years back, Kisan cards were there. Through the budgets, it has come. Now, Kisan cards in this year, it has been replaced by RuPay card, RUPEE, RuPay card. Now, RuPay is a big government agency. Now, they say we are kicking out Visas and Masters. RuPay is my own card. But this is some Indian corporates are coming together, catching hold of few politicians and few bureaucrats and making it as a RuPay, Indian name. Money game is going on. So RuPay is there through all the bank boards. It is coming and RuPay has been foisted. Now what happens to Kisan card? How much investment it has taken in the Kisan card? How it has been utilized and how it has wasted? One should investigate. That probe has to be demanded. Secondly, so far the Visa and Masters, they were the really owners of the credit cards and we were the, they were getting the main income and we were paying them the commissions. So they squeezed the money by operating Indian bureaucrats and Indian politicians, and now we are having our own ATM. Now there are standalone ATMs, there are offsite and on-sites. Now here, each bank has made huge investment for last 10 years. Almost every 3 years, it is in 200, 250 crores, 300 crores, investment is taken place in a bank like size like a Bank of Maharashtra. Bank of Maharashtra is at a tier 3 level. Now you take a State Bank of India, tier 1 level, it comes to something like 2000 crores like that. So such a huge amount is being invested in computation like ATM and the CBS every 3 years, and how ultimately it gets the money return back. So entire that investment cost is shifted on the burden is shifted on the shoulders of customers. That is fact of life. Because in each year balance sheet, as the standard asset had been made a provision, as a bad asset had been made a provision, it is also my wages and pension has been made provision. Similarly, the investment in IT also had been made provision. So ultimately, it is a people's money out of which the whole provisions have been made. So cost of ATM, which is so huge, and all these ATM barons, owners, they are the Indian bureaucrats and the politicians and the ministers and whatnot. So this is the point important. So what happens to the investment is my basic question for last 15 years. And every year the bank's money has been squeezed out by the various companies, whether it is Infosys or ISEC or whatnot. IBM and everybody. So now this is the basically the European companies and American companies are using the financial sector market in a huge way for last 15 years. Now customers in India are being squeezed, but still the only 40% people are getting the technology benefit. 60% people do not have the bank accounts. Now in the name of expanding the banking net to all everywhere, now this ATM biometric card has come. Today I get the information from one bank that in Maharashtra 1000 biometric machines are to be installed very soon, and Sheila Dixit has introduced this thing in the month of January at Delhi. So it is a government's program. It's a government's program, biometric. Now here such a huge cost is there. Now this is owned by the people. So as you rightly said, you have taken up the issue, and as All India Banking Association, we are supporting the customer's cause, we are supporting the deposit's cause. So we are one with this cause of why this kind of a cost should be borne by the customers at general. Now one is a thumb impression. Now the real hard fact is all these machines are dumped in the metro, urban and semi-urban areas and not in the rural areas where thumb impression are more. Now saying that, stating that, the urban financial inclusion is also very, very important, and which is Aadhaar link. So what? So we are dumping, we are putting all these biometric ATMs in Mumbai, Pune, and all these district places. So this is something ridiculous, and this is what we have to attack. Now 60% of the people do not have the bank accounts. They are in the rural side, district side, taluka side. There the biometric is really of worth, I can say. But then this technology is not provided to that kind of a customer. They don't have any bank account. So this is something only the market pushers or market operators, they are fleecing the bank's money, that is people's money, and therefore we have to oppose this kind of a lobbying from RBI top, this kind of a opposing from finance ministry, and all these fears, as you are using the correct word, fatwas. The fatwas are coming. They are not talking to any investors group. They are not talking to any customers group. They are not talking to unions. I represent the board, but the boards are only getting the proposals of how much investment is to be done in the ATMs. How much investment done to them, CBS, and crores of rupees are doled out without any giving details of it. In spite of our best questions put across the board, we don't get explanations. So it is virtually thrust upon system. So that is exactly happening right from the Rajiv Gandhi's days in the name of technology. And today, it is at height of the day, you are rightly raising the question. UADI is also linked with that, and ultimately, this is a big racket going on in India. We have to oppose this.
I am Ashok Rawat. I am Honorary Secretary of All India Bank Depositors Association. I would like to raise only two questions. One is connected with banking and one is not connected with banking. The one which is not connected with banking is that whether we as a nation need a unique identification system where each citizen or as she put out, a resident is identified, whether we first need that. I think each citizen should be identified that we need such a system. Whether Aadhaar is satisfying that particular thing, well, that is to be deliberated. Second thing, there are many schemes by which the subsidy is provided to the poorer section of the society. Whether we need a system to, so that it really goes to the beneficiaries and there are no leakages. So these are the things that we should also deliberate. Now coming to the banking system, whether you want financial inclusion for all the people in India, whether the system which is needed for government to give subsidies can be used for making them bank customers. So this is one of the things which must be debated. And I personally feel that financial inclusion, as you rightly said, must start with the rural area first and find out what is the experience there and then spread it in the urban areas for the poor people. Because if you find that in urban areas the poor people, they are today being served by business correspondents who are just outside the bank branches. They are not anywhere else, you see. So the urban poor are anyway served by present system today. Ruler poor are not served by system. Therefore, financial inclusion and especially banking inclusion, what can be done about them? That is the question which can be discussed.
Rajendra Thakkar, Forum for Fast Justice. बहुत कुछ सुनने के बाद एक ही नतीजे पे आते हैं कि इस नीति का हम सबको मिलकर विरोध करना चाहिए और जो मेमोरेंडम बनाना है वो मिलकर मेमोरेंडम देना चाहिए क्योंकि अधिकांश जो विषय थे सब चीज पे बातचीत हो चुकी है कहने के लिए कुछ ज्यादा बाकी नहीं है इतना ही कहा जा सकता है कि जिस तरह व्यापार करने के लिए लॉबिंग चल रही है ये इसका मुख्य उद्देश्य है और ये सारी चीजें मैं अनुभव कर रहा हूँ कि जब से इस देश में प्राइवेट बैंकिंग आरंभ हो गई है और जैसे जैसे प्राइवेट बैंकिंग को ज्यादा महत्व दिया जा रहा है हम देख रहे हैं कि वो अपने सारी सुविधाओं को पूरा करने के लिए जनता के पैसे का उपयोग कर रहे हैं और यही इसका अल्टीमेट लक्ष्य है तो सबसे पहले धन्यवाद देता हूँ मनी लाइफ को सुचिता जी को कि बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण मुद्दे को उठाया और अब इस विषय में जो भी आप कहेंगे उसमें हमारे फोरम फॉर फास्ट जस्टिस और मुंबई महानगर व्यापारी परिषद का पूरा सहयोग रहेगा अब इस विषय को मैं हिंदी में ट्रांसलेट करके चार दिनों के अंदर पूरे व्यापारी समाज में जितने एसोसिएशन हैं उन सबको मैं भेज दूंगा
I would like to introduce Mr. Ashok Maniar from All India Business Council in case he would like to share any points.
Just a couple of points. With all due respect to all the points that were put forth, I just feel that after hearing out the entire discussion, in my humble opinion, when you prepare the memorandum, if you put more thrust on proving that the whole basic Aadhaar scheme, the UIDAI scheme itself is highly flawed. In my opinion, the excessive thrust should be on that part because that would automatically put every other scheme that's linked to Aadhaar onto a standstill. Once you tell them that your Aadhaar itself is a highly, highly, highly flawed scheme itself, because again, just to go back to the costs and everything, as people rightly pointed out, yes, an ATM is not such a lucrative business for banks anymore. As far as I know, most of the banks have started moving out of their traditional ATM biz model whereby they would lease out a 50-75 square feet space and put up their ATM machines and the security and stuff. The system that goes on now is if you have a 50-75-100 square feet place, the bank will sub-franchise their entire ATM unit to you. You are supposed to invest the 3 or 5 lakh rupees and buy your own ATM machine. You are supposed to put up the bank's hoarding. You are supposed to arrange for the security out there. You are supposed to coordinate with the bank's people to refill the money every day in and out. So it's totally, and the whole business model has changed in such a way that people who have those kind of places and have that kind of money to put in, so rather than putting that money at 9% in a bank in an FD, they would make this as an investment and just hope that they get the kind of returns which are even if it's marginally higher than what they would get out of a bank, they would be more than happy with it. From the bank's perspective, they've got a huge risk off their back. They've got like a target for 50-100 ATMs to put up. It's been put up, it's been taken care of, but they are nowhere directly involved. So as far as this cost of implementing these new ATM machines and everything is concerned, they have a very convenient way to shrug off their this thing and come out of it and say, no, there's no way we are going to burden the customers and the consumers with all this thing. This is what we have. This is the mechanism which we have in place. This is what it has been happening over the years, and there is no way that the customer is going to be get burdened, and they are very conveniently going to move out of it. So the thrust, in my opinion, should more be on the fact that Aadhaar itself, when you're taking biometric scans and retina scans of people and entrusting the entire data to companies in US and other countries, third party, fourth party, as ma'am rightly pointed it out. How can you guarantee the security of your Indian citizens, Indian residents, when the such critical data, which is which identifies them of the existence, is so highly compromised? As sir rightly said, you know, it's not the entire fingerprint image that goes in. If it has to match up with about say 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore fingerprint database, it has to be a very small file. If it's that minuscule a file, what are the chances of it having a very strong encryption? I mean, you have 12 years and 14 years old who are hacking into the income tax department databases and of high celebrities. I mean, with that kind of and on the other hand, when your data goes to companies in the US who have organizations like NSA and CIA with absolute brute force when it comes to technology, I mean, what chances does a country like ours stand, you know, when so critical database of theirs is being so highly compromised? So that's, in just my humble opinion, I think there should be an equal amount of thrust on the fact that Aadhaar itself, on which this whole scheme has been based, that itself is flawed. When that itself is not good enough, how can you move on to any further scheme based on that scheme? Yeah, thank you.
It's a well thought upon point, you know, by the gentleman, that when we are putting across our points, let us focus on the anomalies in the Aadhaar project. In continuation, it will automatically serve the purpose. But this particular viewpoint portray will not be strategically correct. As per my opinion, we have to be diplomatically very, very correct, because we are up in arms against a very strong lobby. So if we go on and tell them that, look boss, the Aadhaar itself is very flawed, you know, so they might just come back to us accusing that you are using this particular route to lobby against the Aadhaar system. So they might just completely cut us out. Our core requirement or our core strategy is to ensure that people's money is not lost in the experimentation of this particular project, and that should be the only core criteria at this point of time. Going forward, once this is achieved, we can look at pointing out further anomalies to stop other projects, but not at this point of time.
You know, I tend to agree with that point of view, because while your point is extremely well taken, I think if you want to attack the RBI, it has to be only on costs, because they have a belief in the Aadhaar system. We should bring that up. I mean, like I said, we are lucky that today we are no longer having to prove whether Aadhaar works or not. We've got a Supreme Court stay order. So I'm saying that instead of getting into details, we'll say, let that case be decided. Till then, you can't spend this money, and it's our money. And you know, I'm giving clear examples. Even SMS, which was a security measure that they're going to tell you, they're charging you 60 rupees. It's now reached the stage where, and I'm part, you know, as he said, he's on the board of banks, services committee, at every single meeting, whenever they speak at the IBA, HDFC Bank is one of the at the forefront of it. They're constantly complaining about the high transaction costs and that technology is very expensive. In fact, we even went and asked them once at one of the meetings that we had with the RBI, that if banks don't know how to balance their balance sheet and they don't know what it's going to cost them and how much they are spending, and it's a discovery process for them suddenly that the cost of transactions is so high, then on what basis are they judging a steel plant and a fertilizer plant and advancing money? They don't know what is happening in their books. But as we find through the circular, half the time it is a fatwa. So RBI has asked them to spend, they're spending. And you know, even today we have, say, I'm on Bank of Baroda, so 1,000 more ATMs. So ask them a question that you had ATMs, so why are you investing? Why is each one investing? Why are the ATMs so close to each other? They have no answer, because as Mr. Utke will say, that there is money to be made in splurging on machines. Okay, so they are not going to protest. They say RBI has asked us, we'll place an order for 4 lakhs. And then, as he pointed out, the money can come through us, as in transaction costs, or it can come through the government. Other than private banks, the government is constantly recapitalizing tens of thousands of crores of our money straight from the exchequer goes to recapitalized banks. It's again our money, right? So I thought we'll remove the first two paras, because we started with Times of India on 12th September. Till yesterday, we didn't know about this circular. And it just so happened that Yogesh was Googling for today's meeting, and he discovered this circular is already issued on the 2nd. So even when Times and Economic Times wrote this on 12th, they said RBI is about to issue the circular. It was 10 days since it has been issued. And what is amazing is that the RBI has a PR department which sends this out. The PR department has not sent it out, not even afterwards. They haven't even told anyone that, look, the circular is already out there. Right? So some of these circulars are just quietly sent out to banks, and they don't. The last time we had a discussion here was on how they were going to charge us for all non-electronic transactions. Okay, so every cash transaction, that was similar. There was a report, no press release. It just gets quietly issued, and it's on the website. By chance, I happen to be Googling for something else, and I discover this report is up on the RBI website. They make no attempt to publicize it, no public debate, while they ought to have put it out there. And definitely no talk with stakeholders at all. And I think we are the largest stakeholders. We are going to pay for it, right? Now, I'm really glad that the All India Bank Employees Association is with us, because, you know, they're such a huge and strong group that if we have support from the inside, I think there is no, you know, no group that's bigger than us. We, customers, they're the bank employees. So I think if two sets of people can't get this stalled, I don't know, you know, we then consider going to court, because that's the third option. So we'll... I think what we should start, if somebody can help us, or we just go ahead, but we could start with the fact that we are surprised at the 2nd September circular that has been issued. Yeah? A circular issued by the Reserve Bank of India on 2nd September. You got a copy of the circular? They issued it again, apparently, to urban banks. Cooperative. Write the title of the circular. We have a piece of this if you want to look at it and suggest points.
Point number one,
free
to mobile text provider?
Yeah, it's free. It costs a mobile text provider zero to provide you an SMS. It's built into the system. It's part of the hardware. It's part of the hardware software solution. No. The government agreed to allow them to charge a small amount. Remember when phone calls cost 16 rupees and 32 rupees? At that time, because there was not much money to be made on calls, they were allowed to make money on SMSs. That situation is long since gone, and certainly I would say in the area of SMSs for security reasons, it's completely ridiculous to charge customers for it. Because the mobile companies are not, it's not costing them even one paisa.
Yeah, less than one paisa.
Exactly what you want to say.
They are
not sending the data,
they
are sending a blank packet.
Exactly. So they might as well send data.
So just tell us technically what to say.
I think we should add after two customers, we should just add this service costs mobile companies nothing. Or does not cost mobile companies anything, whatever.
The SMS charging cost, actually the mobile operators were allowed to do so only till the time their infrastructure cost really gets recovered. Okay, which is long ago. No, correct. So, while you are writing it there, okay, what you can simply write is, okay, under the same directive that it was, okay, their cost is already recovered. Okay, they might charge their customers for whatever they charge. Okay, but these transactional SMSs, okay, these are categorized as transactional SMSs and not a separate type of SMS, a regular type of SMS. Okay, so such transactional SMSs, especially for financial institutions, the mobile operators have to waive it off, you know. So that charge shouldn't be actually levied, because mobile operators are not supposed to be actually levying that charge.
Then what we can say is such transactional SMSs
for
mobile companies.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. Of course.
So, you know, under the
such transactional text messages cannot be charged by the mobile operator.
Correct, yeah. No, no, no. Ultimately, mobile operator is charging the bank, and the bank is leaving their charge on the customer. So it's a pass on charge. Sir, the banks are charging because the operators are charging them.
That's the only excuse.
Yeah. No, no, no. I come from the industry. I'm in telecoms.
No,
yeah.
So.
When the mobile operation started in India in 1994-95, SMSs which were supposed to be charged, like some gentleman here said, okay, it was only there, okay, because they had very less MOUs, that is minutes of usage, okay. So once the cost of SMSE, the basic setup cost of the SMS gateway is covered, they are not supposed to be really charging it, okay. That is long been, but it's never been changed then. Okay, so at least under this provisions of for financial institutions, they should do it, that the operators should give it free to the banks or the financial institutions, where the financial institutions are not leaving the charge on the customer there.
You're saying is the banks are right now charging because
Yeah. Rather, transaction SMSs are costing more than promotional SMSs. Yeah.
But you're saying the operators are charging?
Yeah, they are.
So then they'll pass on that charge, no? So actually,
RBI can direct DOT to give them a direction under this service.
RBI can't direct DOT?
No, RBI can't.
No,
under
can't.
Public safety or the public whatever.
RBI won't be able to direct DOT.
They can at least write. The governor can write, I'm sure.
We can, yeah.
Yeah, so the DOT can then direct.
So they cannot be charged by banks is not correct.
Banks can charge because the operators are charging
at this point. The sentence is not correct.
The banks association should take objection.
Correct. Yeah. Ideally, the banks have to take it. Yeah.
Why not?
Should not be charged by banks. as the mobile operator that's supposed to provide this service.
Yeah, that's
maybe right, that's diplomatically correct.
Should not be charged. Should not be charged by banks as the mobile operators are supposed to provide.
See, the classification is very clear. Transactional and promotional are differently classified at the mobile operator's level.
Provide these messages.
No, currently also is classified. So whenever you send a SMS, which is like some promotion, even from the bank, okay, it's charged separately. The accounts are separate.
At no cost, just put a full stop.
Sucheta, yeah, I think.
I think Bank of Baroda is also not.
They're all doing one by one.
Okay, I think we should be very, very diplomatic.
Sorry, can we go one at a time, please?
I personally think that.
Go ahead. No, we are charging. One by one, we are charging. Read our cover story.
I personally think that we don't have the relevant data and statistics in terms of proof and identity to come to a statement. So let's be diplomatically correct.
What?
As to exactly understand, none of us have, you know, are in a stage where to go and verify from DOT or RBI governor.
In the industry, so they're not supposed to transact.
Correct.
We are saying that's fine.
So let us be diplomatically correct. Let us write that such transactional test messages, which should have been free to the consumers, are now being charged at 60 rupees per annum.
We've said that on the top.
No need to repeat.
Because this particular statement can go against us. They may just come out.
Nothing goes against us so easily. We are all activists. We are not in a court of law. So, okay, as long as we are factually correct, it's fine. No point in being too diplomatic. I think Indrani's point is important. Please help us frame it. That there is no recourse at the moment.
Yes.
You know, the circular makes no mention of grievance redress, and there's no recourse if any of the biometrics are.
Yes,
wrong.
Because the bank itself is not taking charge of that. It is linked to the account.
So any of you experts want to tell us how to frame that? You know, the point she made, I don't know whether you'd come, is... Yeah.
So,
what about clearing that line? This where the instances of electronic fraud, it is not, but no connection.
Yeah, that's correct. This is the first line says, the levy of charges for mobile text messages which you introduced as a useful security measure. That's why you get text messages. Supposing 5,000 bucks are taken from your account.
I'm so sorry. My name is Sujoy Chaurasia. I also come from industry which rides between the two. Can you hear me clearly? I have worked myself into the POS industry with one of the industry leaders called Ingenico. to tell the forum out here, biometrics has been tested out in India. There's a company called Fino, funded by ICICI Bank, which was supposed to do the financial inclusion. They already have roughly around 45,000 terminals, which are biometric terminals, out in the rural field. Again, the same concept of BC appointed the FIs and all that stuff. And believe me, that entire system has failed very badly. In the 45,000 terminals. Fino has already done it, and now they've become aggregators. So someone wants to take a BC as a franchisee of a bank and give this service. Fino's provides that entire infrastructure to these kind of companies, and it's a very cost-heavy kind of a thing. So when coming back to our point of disconnect here, banks are just charging you for a service they're providing. It's nowhere linked with what the mobile operator is charging them. So this 60 rupees is no way connected to, I don't know, first of all, 60 rupees, I am a ICICI Bank golden customer, I have never paid this kind of money. Absolutely, absolutely. I totally agree.
I think you should go to our website, because we have gone and checked which banks have charged it. Okay. And each one by one has started it. And almost like a cartel, five of them issued press releases on a single day. Apart from that, we obviously, even this program is funded by ICICI. It's sponsored by them.
Okay.
We are very much in touch with the banks. We are talking to RBI. RBI, in fact, has now assured me yesterday that they are going to put pressure on banks to stop charging it.
Absolutely.
So banks are charging.
Absolutely. That should be our point. It's a service that the bank has to anyway provide.
It doesn't matter, no? But the point to make, to underline the point that they are not paying for it, so why are they charging us? And especially when it started as a security measure, is what we're putting in here.
No, my entire thought process here is, why are we entering into their equation with the telcos? We know that telcos do not pay as such. I mean, there's not a huge cost which is levied for that. It's a service which is being charged to me as a bank's customer.
I'll tell you what, you have come in here today, but this SMS issue is something we have, as Moneylife Foundation, been taking up for the last 2 months at least. We've written cover stories on it. We've done surveys on it. So we've sent a memorandum to the RBI. So the fact of SMSs being charged when it started as a security measure is something that we've taken up already.
Okay.
Now we are adding by making
that,
this
that makes
additional
sense.
Point.
I mean, it makes sense. Let's articulate it out here.
I thought this is clear enough, isn't it? Shouldn't we go to the next one?
Yeah, absolutely.
If you're in a minority of one, then we will...
No. It's absolutely...
Does anyone else feel we should change it? No. Oh, it's okay. No. Okay, so...
Thank you.
To add the points about who owns the UIDA and you have to buy the data, because I think JTD was making... Okay. Right. Who made the point? You made it. That the system is such that you have to buy, you know, UIDA is going to own the data, right? So each time there will be a cost of getting... Correct. Benefits, and I think we should add that what is not publicly known is that every single transaction will have a cost attached to it, because your UIDAI will have sells the data and will have to be paid for each transaction. Is that correct? Okay. Every transaction. For verification and authentication. this is part of UIDAI's, what did you call it?
How is the funding coming?
Yeah. Part of business plan. Yeah. So the cost of this transaction, these transactions have not been disclosed while issuing the circular makes no mention about the cost of these transactions.
It says small fee. Yes.
The circular also says. Okay, next point, Vikram has. That's right. So, next point Vikram has drafted. It's puzzling. Anyone wants to pitch in as to order and all that also, please tell us the order of points.
If the Aadhaar, if the UID system provided by UID itself is faulty,
anything coming from them is also
Two banks are doing eKYC and just Aadhaar based accounts. HDFC, because we wrote to them, somebody in our office got a bank account opened with just Aadhaar. And we were surprised because until then we were under the impression that Aadhaar is one of the identifiers. But HDFC wrote back when I asked them, is it correct? They said yes. We are, you know, and RBI has issued another circular which we need to dig out, where they said only UIDA is good enough. And yesterday somebody tweeted that Access has started it. So two banks are doing it with only Aadhaar. That's where it gets dangerous. Nothing else.
Can we read the whole of
Yeah. Well, you can just be a resident. You manage to get a UID. And what is important is Aadhaar you can get with a letter from an MP. And MPs have been issuing letters very liberally.
Some other financial institutions like insurance, okay, which are also using this, or basically the UI, the Aadhaar card, okay. If you are an insurance customer, for example, an ICICI Prudential customer, okay, you can have your details changed, and while they are verifying for the change of the change request, okay, they take your Aadhaar authentication as a valid authentication and they change it. So if there is a lapse, it is not only on bank side, it is on your other financial this also. So I'm sure, I'm aware about insurance because my wife hails from the insurance industry, okay. But I'm not aware about the mutual funds and all this. But I'm sure it is, this is something that is not only impacting banks, it is impacting all financial institutions. You can change all your financial data, okay, because everybody has started accepting Aadhaar. ICICI Prudential does. No, so wherever is it's an authentication, like for example, there were frauds on insurance frauds, which were being done by address change, basically. Okay, so currently, the ICICI Prudential has started accepting that if I have to, say, change the address for my wife's policy, okay, and if I am giving, an authentication is done via Aadhaar, okay, then it is authenticated and they do it on phone. Okay. Yeah, okay, so they are doing that. Okay, that's a process that's getting implemented. Okay, so you have to understand it is impacting the insurance industry. It is impacting maybe even the mutual fund industry might start this. Okay, so it's a serious threat.
No, somebody else.
No, there would be a second mode of authentication.
But once it is authenticated by Aadhaar, see, there is an entire process. But ultimately, they are including Aadhaar into it. Okay, where if Aadhaar gets, if it is authenticated via Aadhaar online, okay, then you can change your address immediately.
Okay, so let's take his example where he hasn't got his Aadhaar. Hmm. So somebody has probably got hold of it and used it to open a bank account because that's all you
maybe,
need.
Yeah.
And he pretends he's him. So yeah. Once he knows where he is, he can call up, give that number and probably change all
probably
the address.
Probably not call up, but online, yes, 100%. Not too very sure about call up, but online it is 100%. So when you give an online for your address change on insurance, okay, it just validates with Aadhaar. Okay, and it takes you further.
So this is the danger, right? Because you haven't got your Aadhaar number. Somebody can take that and just give that and get an account opened in ICICI Bank. And then they just need to know who you are to change the at least the address. That's part one. After that, hacking into your account is not such a difficult thing once they have...
Yeah, correct. If they have one particular communication mode open, then it's done. Like even your email address. Forget an address. Even your email address. You know, that's a major security breach because everything that comes to you is on your email ID if you're going online to transact everything. Yeah. And done. You know, you're through.
All the recent frauds have been done by diverting the mobile number, diverting the email ID. These two things are diverted in the bank's records. The fraud takes place and then what's your
okay, point number three.
Excuse me, I'd like to add here that, hi, my name is Shantanu Bhide. I am from and I would like to add when you said about authentication from Aadhaar card, it has been there from 10th of September. I was checking RBI's press releases and the release that we are looking at before, it has been released on 3rd. It was there because through the RSS feed, they are always releasing whatever it is. And I keep track of it because of some other reason regarding like their treasury notes and all. So I was just going through it and on 10th of September, they have released that Aadhaar card or UID online, that KYC, it can be used as a official proof. So you can just take that and it's okay.